Welcome to A Living History of Bronxville. We have somebody today who most of you who watch cable TV, and now it's channel 72. If you found it, you're fortunate and probably better than a lot of us in trying to find it. We have somebody that most of you know, and that is Nancy Vittorini. Nancy, welcome, and we're delighted to have you here today.
I'm delighted to be here, Marcia. Thank you for having me.
I've got to say something. Nancy is the biggest kept secret in Bronxville. I mean, you may have seen her a lot on television, but I bet you don't begin to know all that Nancy has done. And we're going to really spend some time on something major. She has just published a book. But Nancy, before we begin on your book, let's just give a little background on your history and your life. You actually were born in Hawaii?
Yes. My father was stationed in Pearl Harbor right after World War II, and that's where I was born.
And in fact, you've spent a great portion of your life associated in the Navy. In the Navy.
Right.
I mean, on the media side, but with the Navy. You were in the Philippines for a long time.
Right. We were, when I was married to my first husband, we lived in the Philippines, and I worked with the Far East Network over there.
Right. You had a show. You had a little show there.
A little show.
Yeah. And you were in advertising for one of the newspapers there. Is that correct?
Well, more in a communications specialist for the recreation group there, mm-hmm. which reaches out to all of the eastern divisions of the military out there. So but most of my experience was in San Diego.
In San Diego. And what did you do there?
Most of my time was spent with a newspaper, the San Diego Union Tribune. I started out as a copywriter and then kind of moved my way through the marketing and advertising management positions there.
And you were there for some 20 years or
almost
so.
Almost 20 years, yeah.
And then fast forward
to where we are today.
Right. I mean, when did you move to Bronxville?
1993.
And you are, how did you meet Carlo? Most of you probably know that Nancy's married to Carlo Vittorini, who is the former chairman of Parade magazine.
Just retired. I met him through the newspaper business. We were at a conference, and I had been thinking about moving to New York, and I was offered a position at Random House in their children's division. So I decided to make the jump, and I joined Carlo. And the rest is history.
And you have two children.
Two children, Frank and Ashley.
Uh-huh. And we'll find out later that Nancy has done so much in the community. But Nancy, let's now go to this new book. It's called This is such a wonderful book. I mean, first tell us about the theme.
Well, it's a compilation of columns that I've written over the past 5 years for React magazine, which was...
Tell us about React magazine.
React magazine is a magazine that's published for teenagers. It's read by about 4 million teenagers every week. It's distributed through newspapers, similar to Parade magazine. It's kind of Parade's baby sister. The columns that I've written for the past 5 years, this is just a selection of them.
You've gathered and what do you write about teenagers? I mean, what's the theme here?
Well, they're kind of ordinary teenagers doing extraordinary things. They're really magnificent. And one thing I found by doing this is that you see a lot of negative things in the press about teenagers these mm-hmm. days, particularly. But what I found through my research and what I do every week is that there are far more who are doing very good things and really making a major impact on the world, and whether
and
it's
here
their own
are.
Little world or the global world. Mm-hmm. They reach out anywhere from their own backyard to Rwanda or to South America, and they're doing wonderful things.
And it's about time we started singing the praises of these kids. I mean, how do you, before we talk maybe a few of them, how do you select these teenagers?
Well, over the past 5 years, I've had built up quite a big contact list of people, and now nicely enough, they contact me. But before, when I was just beginning the column, I started with organizations that work with young people.
Such as the Boy Scouts.
Girl Scouts, the Boys and Girls Club of America, an organization like the Giraffe Organization that rewards people for sticking their necks out. And I found that there are a lot of other organizations, the Points of Light, America's Promise, Youth Venture, Youth Service America. There are a great number of organizations that are working with teenagers, and they really bubble to the top, mm-hmm. and it's not hard to find them.
Mm-hmm. Now, each one, how many teenagers did you cover in this book?
Oh, gosh, I don't know the answer to that question.
But each one of them has a lovely picture about them. I mean, you know, we'll hold
I
up some.
I love the layout. Dakila Davina and some other people at Parade Magazine actually mm-hmm. did the layout for the
big picture of the teenager.
Yeah.
Pick a few. I mean, who comes to mind as some of the most courageous?
Well, they do. That's a nice way to word it, because they fall into about three different categories. And I've found over the years that I write about teenagers who display incredible amounts of courage, or are incredibly compassionate, or have a great amount of conviction about what they do. And that's kind of, those are the people who I write about. Logan Johnson is one of my favorites. He's a My sister-in-law had alerted me to Logan. She saw him in the local paper, and what he had done is he was delivering pizza, and he was in an intersection and saw that a car was careening off the road and kind of going up an embankment and jumping into a lake, right into the middle of the lake. And he said, "Oh my goodness." And he turned to the right, threw off his cowboy hat, his boots. He said he took his wallet out, and he just dove into the water and was able to save the man in the car. The man had become unconscious and had gone off the road into the lake. Mm-hmm. The most fascinating part of this is that 2 weeks before that, and he said, he just mentioned this to me at the end of the interview, because I said, "Is there anything else you'd like to share?" He said, "Well, I guess I can tell you this. 2 weeks before that, I wanted to commit suicide, or I tried to commit suicide."
Oh,
and
wow.
He said, "This whole experience changed my life."
Mm-hmm.
And
Isn't that something?
And so what I find...
Nancy has tears in her eyes. I have tears in my eyes, too.
What I find is oftentimes the hardest part of my interviews are maintaining my emotional stability, because the kids are doing such wonderful things, and they have mm-hmm. such incredible depth of emotion yeah. and what they care about.
Right.
And it's right up at the top.
Well, maybe there's just another one.
There's plenty of them. This is a timely one. This is a story about Rashad Williams and Lance Kirkland. And one of those victims in the Columbine High School shooting
sure.
in Littleton, Colorado. And Rashad Williams had heard of the shootings and had heard specifically about Lance, and knew that Lance did not have medical insurance to cover his costs for all his medical care. And a week before the San Francisco Beta Breakers, he decided that he was going to run in the race and get funds donated for his completing the race. And he collected $12,000, and a month later had gone over to Littleton to meet Lance and paid for at least partially some of his
expenses.
Isn't
that a wonderful, wonderful story?
Never ever knew him, just knew uh-huh. that he needed help.
That's wonderful. And you said also earlier that you had interviewed a woman,
yes,
a young teenager, who was deaf.
Yes, that was really...
Now, how did you do that?
I mean, fabulous experience. That was hard, because this one, I'll find it here in a second. This is young Eliane Lawson. Deaf children, how to play the piano. And you say, "Well, how in the world did you interview her if she was deaf?" Well, it turned out that you were able to call a computer operator. The operator then patches into her at her home. And so I asked the questions of the operator, who then types out the questions on this special equipment, which is then sent electronically to her home through the computer. And she reads the questions and then answers them. So there's a major time delay. But she had more courage than you can imagine, and was not going to let anything stop her. She was not born deaf. She grew deaf through an illness, and she had perfect pitch. She wanted to become a singer, and she's a beautiful piano player, and so now she's deciding to use her skills to help other children have the joy of playing the piano. And you say, well, why would they want to play the piano if they can't hear it? And she said, I hear it through the vibrations, and it's beautiful.
Isn't that wonderful? That's great. Well, Nancy, we could spend the whole interview on your book, on this book, but you have two other books I want to talk about. I mean, you didn't know this about Nancy Vittorini, did you? Nancy had published by Random House two previous books. The first one was called Smiles and Kisses came first. Tell us a little bit about the themes. So these are great themes in this book.
Well, what I found, Marcia, that we talked about a little bit before, that as my children, Frank and Ashley, were younger.
Now, Frank and Ashley are how old right now?
15 and 14.
Catch this. We're going to develop this theme in a second here.
And when they were younger, I used to read to them all the time. That was real important to me and the children. And as I was reading the children's stories to them, I said to myself, I should be doing this because I can write. You know,
sure.
I think every mother says they can write children's books.
Isn't
right?
that true? We
anyway,
all want, right,
a
one.
Good friend of mine agreed that she should have been writing children's books too. So we kind of got together, and we are, I guess, we can be kind of annoyingly positive because everything about us, we face the world in a very positive light. And Joan Wilson and I decided that let's show children how to face the world, starting right off at the first bat, and these are really almost baby books, how to be positive and how to look for the positive in everything there is.
How do you do that in the book, though?
I mean, well, these wonderful illustrations are by Ellen Duras. She was a resources, and we just pulled some poems together, and Pajamas Hug Us.
That,
all the ways that things hug or smile or kiss. So everything that they see about them in their world.
A bear smiles.
Right.
When he's snuggled in bed. You even have the sun smiles when it rises in the morning.
Yes, the sun smiles. And then we did the similar approach with Hopes, Dreams, and Wishes.
But that's for a little older child or the same?
Not really. Yeah. About the same. This is toddler, just children and toddler. Depending on the age, you can really introduce concepts. Dogs dream of dinosaur bones. And then we had all kinds of other ideas like tickles, giggles, and grins, and they're in the drawer waiting to be published.
So many things that we all have are. Well, I think it's interesting that you wrote these when your children were young.
Yes.
And now you're doing, now that they're teenagers,
I'm writing
you're doing this.
Teens, yeah.
Can we expect a book maybe not Catcher in the Rye, but something age something 20 to 20, 24 as they
well,
move
it's
on?
Interesting, Marcia. My son Frank said to me the other day, what now, Mom? Because unfortunately React is not, has announced that it's going to cease publication.
Oh,
because
I'm sorry.
It was a dual audience magazine. It did very well in reaching both the young teens, male and female. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, most advertisers want to target directly to a young
a female
girl
or a male. Isn't
both.
That unfortunate? You're trying to do both genders, sexes at the same time, but you just can't get the advertising for it.
Right. So that's unfortunate, but then it's just a new door to new opportunities.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure what comes next. My son said, why don't you be a novelist? And I said, I think that's too lonely. I like to be around people, and that's why I love Bronxville.
I know. It's a lonely life being a novelist.
Yes.
I know that. Not that I am one myself, but I know it can be lonely writing. Nancy, you have done so much in the community, and one of the ways we know you is through this show you do. You've done two shows, Dateline, Bronxville, but that's not how you started. You started
with the Bronxville School Report.
Tell us a little bit about the Bronxville School Report.
Well, it's wonderful, and it's grown to such professionalism now. I did it just it was really kind of a lark. I was with Irina Choi Stern one day, who had been working on it for a while, and she unfortunately had someone booked for a show to do the Memorial Day show, who had to back out at the last minute because of a job. And she said, I don't know what I'm going to do. And she said, would you do it? And I said, why not?
So, a star is born. The opportunity is there, and you're there at the right time.
And then Madeline Odin and I kind of partnered up since then, and we really enjoyed doing Dateline Bronxville.
How often do you do Dateline? Once a week or once?
No.
It's less than that.
Maybe 4 to 6 times a year, and sometimes specials. We've done some specials. We really do it as time permits.
Yeah.
You know, we're all doing
And what do you try to focus on? New events in...
what's going on in Bronxville.
Yeah.
And that's the most exciting part for me is I really... It's my job now to know what's going on, so I really do stay in tune with what's happening in the community. And Mayor Hand also gives us a lot of good direction on goings on. And then, of course, we just like to be out in the village with the people and show how beautiful it is in the springtime. We've done, you know... shows about the flowers, and we've done shows about Christmas and catching people on the street at, you know, Chamber of Commerce events, and of course the highlight was the centennial.
The centennial. I've got to inject this. The person who does all the filming is, of course, filming this very television show, Peter North.
Yes, Peter North, my buddy.
And I'm going to look away from the camera towards Peter. A great
we all love Peter.
Amount of gratitude for all that he has done.
He's taught me everything I know.
Well, not everything, but I know he's taught you some things.
Yes.
Right?
He's got a lot of good outtakes of me.
My favorite one is your centennial, and I know that took a lot of effort, but that was, what did you include in that? I mean, how did you go about
Well, we did a number of shows throughout the centennial year, beginning with the flag raising, just covering every centennial event, because we really thought it was, we were making history. We were making history, and so we chronicled that through videotape, and then... the two major events, celebratory events, were in the spring and in the fall. Memorial Day weekend, we had the huge centennial celebration and parade and
Still think of you and Madeline sitting somewhere perched watching the parade.
That's right, doing the parade, trying to pretend that we were at Macy's Thanksgiving Day parade and doing live coverage. And then in the fall as well with the centennial ball, the house tour, the Victorian tea. So
did you get to the croquet game?
Yes, I did.
Good, that was
a good
game.
And I have a great picture of you in your beautiful gown.
I didn't play, but
well, you were there though, serving tea. As
right.
I recall.
Well, we all. That was what was so wonderful about the centennial. I think, you know, a way was found to get everybody who wanted to be included.
And after the year was over, it was such a fantastic year, and we did have great coverage. We had great footage, and we had really tried. My main goal was to make sure that everybody who was involved was on that videotape and sometime throughout the year. And then we were asked to do just a short highlights of the centennial year to be used as a... part of a nomination for an award, which we indeed won. The Centennial Committee won for our celebration.
Fantastic.
But that tape really is really fun because it just takes the highlights of the year and puts it all in one 12-minute segment. Yeah,
it's quite an accomplishment. Now, you have moved on to do something else rather major for the village, and that is this new website that we're putting
in. Well, I'm just helping. I don't know very much about the
internet. Nobody does. We're all on the cutting edge when we do the websites, no matter where.
That's true, when you've got one coming yourself. But... I'm having fun working with Mayor Hand and Julie Cagliostro and Bill Regan and others on Thatcher Drew to help decide what the Bronxville website, the official government website, will look like and what it will include. And it will be very rich with information and very beautiful.
Great. What is the website name? Do you have the name?
We have 3 or 4 different URLs, but we haven't decided on which one.
Which one you're going to do? Oh, you reserved 3 or 4.
And
you
that's right.
Well,
Mayor Hand was smart in doing that.
Right. Well. And when you finally launch it, obviously you're going to let us all know.
Oh, absolutely. But yes.
But it'll cover local events.
It will have a calendar, and it will have a. A welcome to Bronxville, really kind of for those who are not in Bronxville, mm-hmm. to see what Bronxville would be like. And then mostly, and more importantly, it will have all the government information.
Right, and that taxes will be going down next year.
I don't know.
Just
about that.
Kidding. that would launch the website dramatically.
Yeah, I don't know. Unfortunately, we might have to hold our breath on that one.
Well, in addition to the website, you've also been very active in helping helping with the women's club. Tell us what you're doing there. The women's club has put so much effort into. In the last year and a half,
in
reviving itself.
Well, we had a real scare. I had a friend call me and say that they thought that there was a possibility that the women's club house itself would be sold.
I had the same call. Yeah,
and so we kind of got together as a group and put our efforts against really revitalizing, bringing some younger women into the women's club. I'm especially fond of history, and I love, having been in the Centennial, I learned a lot about Bronxville's history, and the clubhouse itself is quite historical. Penrose Stout was the architect,
right.
Of course, Anna Lawrence Bisland was the founder, and I learned so much about all of this anyway, so I've tried to help with that because I really don't want that to go away.
Right, and you're on the Villager. You do the layout.
Well, I've tried to help redesign the Villager,
which is wonderful.
Give it
I
a
have
new
noticed
look,
the change, and it is really
a new feel to it.
Yeah,
a little bit more focused on the village happenings itself, village people, kind of. Bring it up.
I think you've done a great job. It's very interesting. I have it on my coffee table. I have it comes out monthly, right?
Yes, from October through June.
Yeah, if you don't get the Villager or see it, you ought to get that. It's also available at Pickwick's or something like
yes,
that too.
Yes, Pickwick's. Yeah. And the bookstore.
Yeah, and the Women's Club is just doing all sorts of great things.
Yeah, they are.
In art, poetry, any kind of interest you could possibly have, opera, etc. You are also have had quite an unusual life being married to Carlo Vittorini because of his chairing the Parade magazine and being president, being all everything,
publisher
and all that. Tell us a little bit about, this has probably brought you into contact with a lot of very interesting
people. It
certainly
has.
Among them?
Well, having worked in the newspaper business and kind of worked my way up from a junior copywriter, growing in that industry and that field, and then having the opportunity to meet and become friends with publishers of all the major newspapers in the country
has
been
wonderful.
Fascinating.
I'm so envious.
Experience.
Yeah, and the new house with the Condé Nast.
Cy Newhouse owns Parade and Advance Publications. He also owns Condé Nast and a number of other Newhouse properties. But he has been certainly a great influence in our lives and a wonderful man to have been associated with and be associated with. General Colin Powell has been someone else that we've gotten to know. And actually, he wrote the for the cover of my book.
Read
really
the first sentence. I think they should, I thought that was so nice of him to write.
It was, because he said he didn't want to do book covers anymore.
Yeah.
But he said when he saw the book, he couldn't help but do just one more. So that made me feel really good. He writes, "Nothing is as oppressive to young people as feeling that they have no control over their circumstances. And nothing is as liberating as finding out that they can change the world. The youthful activists profiled in this book are an inspiration for their own age group and for the rest of us as well." And
Colin Powell.
Working with the America's Promise, an alliance for youth. So we've been working with him, too, on a few different things that are involved with youth.
And I believe you mentioned, I hope I don't have this wrong, that you and Carlo had dinner with Jack Parr who lived in the village. And some
he
of
did,
us
and he was so nice. He was so nice to me. We through Isidore Rosenfeld, he's a doctor, and he writes for Parade. He's a contributing editor for Parade. And he invited us to his home, and he's a good friend of Jack Parr. And we sat next to each other, and he told me all about his life in Bronxville. And then he sent me the videotape of raising the lions here on Studio Lane.
The lions were something. We, yeah. You know, we live right behind that area, and that was always the talk when he was here.
When he drained the pool so that he could keep the lions in the pool.
Right.
Because there's no other way he could hold them.
Well, this has been so interesting, Nancy. I always end this little show with just some questions about Bronxville and in your impressions of it. And I'm going to do it again.
Okay.
You know, you probably more than most are very familiar with Bronxville and what's happening. What do you see coming down the road for Bronxville? I mean, do you see it staying
the same? Good question. I ask that question of a lot of people, too, Marcia.
I know. Well, now we're putting you on the spot.
Nobody's asked me. Well, you know, one of the things we haven't talked about is the Historical Conservancy.
Right,
that
you're serving on that.
The Centennial Committee. And we've just doubled
the
membership.
You're on the board, right, yeah.
Yes, there were 100 founding members, and we just had a membership drive. And, of course, everybody's still invited to come and be a part of it. But we've doubled the membership already.
Fantastic.
So I think there are a lot of people who really care about the enduring character of Bronxville. And I think Paul Goldberger, you know, said it best when he talked about Bronxville and that its charm would last for 100, 200, 300 years or more.
This is a writer for The New Yorker, right?
Right, and he was one of the first speakers at the Brendan Gill lecture that
series.
The Historical Conservancy is sponsoring.
And there's several subcommittees now working on the Conservancy.
Yes, a lot. Who was who in Bronxville? Patty Dorman is heading that up.
Right.
And there's architectural research and there's art research. Jane Warman has done a lot with that. Marilyn Hill and Eloise Morgan are working very hard on creating a journal. And I'm working on a Conservancy Chronicle to keep people up to date with what's going on. So I think to answer your question is that it has such a wonderful charm about it because
and it's
it is
just
so
not
small.
Women. I mean, Don Gray's been working on it.
Gray
and you've got Bob Riggs in there,
chair,
and you've got a lot of men putting their time into
women.
It. Yeah,
but yes, there are a lot of people involved, and I think that's what's so special about the village is that everybody you meet cares.
Yeah,
they care about whether it's the children, whether it's the teenagers, whether it's the the architecture or the streets or whatever, everybody cares.
They not only care, they're willing to put some time behind it.
And money.
A lot of people.
A lot of time and effort and money and thought and resources. And I've had the joy of meeting a lot of those people through all my different work with all the different media.
Well,
because I like to cover them because they should be recognized.
For what they're doing.
For what they're doing.
We're so lucky to have somebody with your talents here. Contributing to Nancy. And just want to thank you for joining us today.
Well,
and
thank
you very much for joining us. And to thank Peter North once again and again and again for taping this show each time. Now it's early in the morning. Thank you.